Namaskaramus, and namaskaram to all the wonderful musicians here and all the students and everybody else. I want to say right off that I'm not here to convert anybody. I'm here to have a dialogue. And I think we all come with baggage. It's just a human nature to have baggage, and we will see what we will do with it. But I will try and, in conversation, talk to you about what little I know about the form that I practice, and the simple fact that there is a lot of space that is used for Manodharma in this form. The only thing I can request of people is to try and maybe remove yourself from your context and try and dive into the another context to try and understand what really goes on as an idea of improvisation and Manodharma in a different form. It has a different texture. There may be many people here who already know most of what I say today. So for you, I'm just taking coal to Newcastle. Bear with me. And for those who do not, then this is possibly a good opening. So it's as open as that. And so let me start with some very simple basic things. Firstly, you know, every musical form has what you could call a sound. You know, a kind of a sound that encapsulates the whole form. So if you hear that sound, you know, for example, you're listening to Khyal, you're listening to Drupad, you're listening to Carnatic. There is this sound that becomes associated. It's not got to do with a raga. It's not necessarily got to do with one compositional type or one improvisational type. So if I was going to talk about Carnatic music and what is the sound that in a way defines it to our ears, it's a bit reductionist, but I think it's a very important aspect of listening to Carnatic music. Because fundamentally there is this sound that Carnatic music emanates that is very distinct and sometimes even disturbing for the ear that is not used to that sound. And if I was going to just nail that, I will nail it to one kind of a gamaka. Now, this one kind of a gamaka is called a kampita gamaka. So I want to start with that idea of the kampita gamaka, because that's what defines the sound of Carnatic music. If you remove that gamaka from Carnatic music, that specific form of movement, then it will not sound Carnatic at all. You can remove every other form of gamaka and just retain the kampita, it will still sound Carnatic. So that's the power of that one gamaka. So I'm going to talk to you and sing that one for you. And there's more to talk about that. The kampita comes in different shades, in different modes, depending on the raga and the context. But it's more or less a kind of a rotary motion. So if I was going to take a raga like Begada, and there is a kampita gamaka in the swara ma. Now I want you to notice the next note I sing. Now this movement is a classic Carnatic movement. Now, if I don't sing that ma like that, it's not Begada. In fact, we call it the Begada ma. We don't even call it anything else. It's called the Begada ma. Now, this sound is there in every raga, in many ragas. We can also sing. Same thing in ni. Now this many times disturbs people. This sound itself disturbs people. I've heard a lot of people being very... What you need to, need to understand there is the shuddhaness of this swara lies in the fact that you sing that gamaka that way. The acoustic nature of that swara is in Begada, when I sing that ni has got nothing to do with that ni. Ni da pa pa ma. Now, why I'm saying this? It many times may sound like as if, okay, how does a musician know how to define that? Especially because this gamaka, I'll show you another example which makes even more difficult to the ear, is there is no point of reference of movement. All this is kampita. And all this kampita is allowed in Begada. Okay? So it is this sound that defines to a large extent Carnatic music. You will find it in Ma. I'll show you in another note. For example, in the Gandhara. This is a raga called Todi. This is sounds closer to what we'll like to hear. Gari, gari, ma gari, sani da gari. There is a purity to this movement that has to be first understood to the listening ear. There is a bandwidth of purity. The bandwidth of purity the musicians know, and the rasika also knows. If I move the bandwidth more, it will infringe upon the next swara, obviously. But the Gandhara of Todi is this Gandhara. If I remove Kampita Gamaka out of this Gandhara, Todi will collapse right there in front of us. This is acoustically a very important sound. If I take, I have to sing this, I can tell you this in every raga. Bhairavi, R Bhairavi. I can sing it 100 times. I'll still sing the ma exactly. Ma ba da pa, ma ba da pa ma da pa ga ga ri ga ma pa ma ni da pa ga ga ma pa ga ga ma pa da ga ga da pa ga ga ma ri 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 ma. So this you'll find in almost every Carnatic raga. Here actually we make a small differentiation. We use this colloquial term of a heavy raga and a light raga. Now if you want to actually, this is something colloquially used by musicians, everybody. It's very simple to differentiate the two. Those raga in which the Kampita Gamaka is very low in operation, we will call a lighter raga. Those ragas in which, where without the Kampita Gamaka, you can identify the raga. Now, for example, the Mohana. This is still Mohanam. It's already defined. But I can never do this in a Todi or a Bhairavi without the Kampita. So a lot of the times that when we say light raga, we're talking about a raga that actually lacks the heaviness. For us, the Kampita is what gives us weightiness to Carnatic music. And it's important to, in a way, imbibe this sound into ourselves if you want to listen to Carnatic music. Because if you don't, that's why I want to emphasize the idea of what a shuddh note is in Carnatic music. A shuddha madhyama in Begada is only if it is singing ma 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 re sa ma 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 is irrelevant to Begada. Is totally irrelevant. The positional value of a swara is irrelevant to the idea of the raga. The moving value of the swara is what is relevant to the raga. So, which is why Kampitam becomes essential. And I'm saying this right off before we go into Manodharma, because you will see a lot of it and you won't be able to get into the music, because this sometimes, I know, bothers a lot of people. Many people came and said, this sounds like you're singing Besur. I'm not singing Besur. It's just that you're not used to the fact that that is a movement that is very defined, very, very conscious and very cultivated. So, I'm going to go straight into Manodharma and not talk anything else because we don't have much time. First, to the idea of the Alapana. Before going into the form of rendering it, there are some basic ideas of ragas that define, or that, shall we say, guide the texture of the Alapana. This is very important in Carnatic music. There is not, you can't say there is one Alapana frame which is there and every raga is put into that Alapana frame. It's very hard to work that way. There are ragas of different textures, and the Alapana has to be created according to the texture of the raga. The form, the approach, everything varies based on the raga. So what are the kinds of ragas? To try and keep it simple, I'll just talk about three kinds. One are kind of ragas which are older in nature, because they are formed very organically. They are formed by multiple phrases, multiple sancharas that come together and give it a certain swarupa, a certain form. These phrases are handed over through the compositions. I'll talk about the composition separately. But basically, we use these phrases to sing an Alapana. So structurally, what happens in these ragas is it becomes a bit like almost like a Picasso abstract painting, because the swara form is not so important, rather than the phrase form. So then you're playing a jigsaw puzzle with the phrase form. Now, I'll give you an example for one raga like that. A classic raga for like that is raga like Athana. If you ask me what is the scale of Athana, even till today, I do not know. Because no scale is going to define Athana. But I can sing a bit of Athana. So these are all phrases of Athana I sang. Now the Athana's form is such that it is like just patches. And it is in trying to bring these patches and connecting them. So this raga form itself is very, very abstract. This is one form. Then you have those ragas that evolved very much from a scale. You know, it was like you created the scale. And those are ragas, for example, a lot of times Hindustani music has also taken. Charukeshi is an example, for example. Those ragas are scale. There's another little thing that happens in Carnatic music. The same swaram can be said as two different swaras, which is also very unusual. So in Athana, for example, now I would say Nisa Gama Nisa Nisa Da. She'll tell you she's playing the same thing. I'm going to say Nisa Rima Nisa Nisa Da. Both are correct. Nisa Gama Nisa Nisa Da. Nisa Rima Nisa Nisa Da. The point is, you need to know where to sing it as Nisa Rima Risa and where to sing it as Nisa Gama Risa. Because we also have Nisa Gama Risa. We also have that. So this is important to also understand. Then you have the scale-based ragas. Now those ragas are structural. So basically there was a scale put into place and then an interpretative happening was placed onto these ragas. So example of those ragas will be Charukeshi. For example, in what we sing, Latangi, for example. So these are texturally different and don't have so many sancharas in their form itself. So to a large extent, I'm treating them as melodic continuums, melodic swaras that are linked and made into strings. Then you have one more. Those that have been constructed, but they've been themselves constructed in a very complicated scale. Now, it is a constructed raga, but the scale is very complex. For example, so you have a raga called Malavi. The scale is Sari ga ma pa ni ma dha ni sa sa ni ra ni pa ma ga re sa. This is a scale. Now, the structure itself complicates the way you have to approach it. Sari ga ma pa ni ma dha pa ni ma dha ni re ta da ra 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 re. Is a different texture. I'm placing this because I want you to understand this completely influences the whole approach to the Alapana. And what you can do in the Alapana is influenced by the texture of these kind of ragas. These are three major, shall we say, divisions that I've made. Now, how can I approach an Alapana? First, let me just step back a bit. First of all, we all say we are very creative in Alapana. Something that I think we universally say. But first of all, where are we creating? I'm not going to talk about the experiential aspect. That's a slightly more esoteric and metaphysical. I'm not getting there today. But you all say very creative, very creative. But what is, I mean, seriously, let's think about what is very creative. First of all, because anybody sings a 40-minute Alapana doesn't mean it's creative. So I think that has to be first established. Neither does it mean a 3-minute Alapana is not creative. It's possible that everything comes alive in 3 minutes of an Alapana and the evocative spirit of improvisation just flashes by in those 3 minutes. It's also possible it happens in 40 minutes. It's also possible nothing happens for 40 minutes. Okay? In Carnatic music, it's possible for a 3-minute Alapana. It's also possible for a 40-minute Alapana. Now, what actually comes from it is a different story. It depends on the musician. Okay? But both exist parallelly. And what guides that? Okay, so let's look at that a little bit. First, where do we create? Fundamentally, where is the musician really creating? Again, it's a huge topic, but I will just try and show pointers on a few things. On a simple aspect of a gamaka. So if I was going to take just one little phrase from a raga. So like in any music, there are phrases that have been handed to us as identification markers for a raga. So let's take a phrase that's an identification for, say, Shankarabharana. Now, this is a classic Shankarabharam phrase. pa ma ba da pa ma ga ma ta ba da pa ma ga ma ma pa ma da pa da ga ma te ra ra la di ri ri na ra na 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 Now, this is not a phrase you find in a composition. That's where the whole magic is. It's not anywhere else. So in a simple gamaka, you can do it. Like, you can use that simple, and it's completely got to do with the musician's imagination. Of you must sing the ma like ma ma. No, it's completely got to do with context. The moment you change that ma, the same phrase is different. Pa ma pa 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 pa ma pa. Even the pa pa ma pa pa ma pa. So it's just as simple, you know, seems simple at least, you know. You know, yeah, sometimes. But so beautiful, isn't it? I mean, okay, this, I'm not saying it because I'm, it's just so beautiful. I mean, there's so much magic happening in that little thing. So it can be a little point of just that ma and pa. And then, so that's one way we can explore. Another thing also, I mean, there are many things that happens. A few other things is like, there are two known phrases. Something happens in between the two phrases. Now, all musicians will know that sometimes when you're singing the first phrase, the second phrase has already arrived. It's already there. So in any raga you've sung, both are known phrases. They are not phrases that are coming out of thin air, okay? So you know these two phrases. So even if I take the same phrase, now, if I was going to say logically, he sang a classic phrase. I asked him in Tamil, what will you sing next, okay? Now, both are well-known, established Shankarabaram phrases. But then something again happens. Now, between that and... Now, that is where the musician also can sometimes, shall we say, stumble upon magic. Now, whether I'm going to stumble now, I don't know, but we'll see. Even something like this. Now this is, now something can happen with that. Both phrases are established phrases. Now, this is also somewhere some things happen. This is a way of immense creativity. You can just, if it's coming that day, then there's a lot happening. Then there is also, of course, the Nyasa technique, which I think everybody, we all use, is take a point and what you could call a circular motion is played around it. Now, circular could be circular linear or could be circular. I'll change the raga.
Kamboji, pardon?
Raga is Kamboji. A very important Nyasa place in Kamboji is Raga Dha, in the Swara Dha. So then we use that as a bass. Nyasa style. So you use the dha, and then you can also, of course, there's so many ways you can do it. There also, then the phrase also play. Sabash. So now we can, I think these are some simple ways in which a lot can be created in Alapana. Now the question is, what approach is used when you sing an Alapana? So we'll have to go back to also the raga texture and also the approaches. If I sang a raga like Athana, which I sang, or I take another raga called Anandabhairavi. Now Anandabhairavi is full of phrases. It's only phrase. The scale of the ragam is, you can completely forget it. If you want to sing Anandabhairavi, you should, I request the musician to forget the scale. Completely, I mean utterly. So we get the phrase, all the phrases that are essential to the raga from the composition. But the composition has not exhausted everything. So an important part in the Carnatic tradition is that the composition and the improvisation are a cyclical movement. The composition gives us the heart of a raga, but the musician while singing is also expanding the raga so that the next composer uses that expansion to create another composition. So it is in the circular motion. It is not like compositions that were made 150 years have exhausted everything and I'm just parroting everything that is being sung and all I'm singing is that. No, the compositions themselves have moved and the ragas also move. So it's a cyclical movement. So if I take Anandabhairavi, one important aspect is I'll have to sing Anandabhairavi in a very, shall we say, for a lack of another word, very impressionistic way or in a very patchy way. So what leads the patchiness is because the phrase move all over the place. The thing about these ragas, the phrase is not centered on a nyasa point. It is not centered circular. In a raga where the sancharas can be centered onto a specific swara, then you have to deal with it differently. In ragas where the sancharas are naturally spread out, then you approach it differently. You may wonder what that when I sang what did I sing before? Now, the next phrase may seem to people who are not used to Anandabhairavi that it was not connected to the next phrase. That I've not stopped somewhere. But in the raga, the abstractness of the raga makes me move in that direction. So the raga movement itself will be like this. And it's in fact essential that for Anandabhairavi, the raga movement follows that trajectory. It follows the trajectory of the phrase which guides me on the trajectory. I can't decide that my frame is to stand on ga, stand on ma and do nyasa, so I will do it. In Anandabhairavi, it will not work. The only two places where you can stand for nyasa and Anandabhairavi is pa and sa. Tari, you can stand in pa. Ra, you can. Anywhere else, there's no position to hold and stand. So then we also, what we do is that's when using a phrase, using a gamaka, changing with the gamaka helps a lot. So this is one type. Then you have, now if it was a raga that allows for a lot of nyasa, then we can use the form of starting on sa, establishing the raga, moving to rishabha or gandhara and panchama and devata and nishada, depending on the raga. Then that's a kind of what I would like to call a linear circular motion of Alapana singing. So you're moving linearly, but you're always also in a circular motion. Now this is also done in Carnatic music. For example, if I sang Kamboji, I could easily sing it in that form. Or if I sang Shankarabharanam, I could sing. If I sang Kalyani, I could sing. So what I would do, what we classically do is . So one important thing in our tradition is that the first phrase is usually a complete phrase. And the idea is that, in the sense complete phrase, it kind of rounds off the sound of the raga. So there is an immediate investment that happens from the musician and the listener into the sound of the raga. Once you're invested in it, then a lot can happen. But if one of us is not invested, then there's a problem. So, ta la 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 la. Ta di. Ta da ra na. Ta da ra ra di ri. The ga is very important in Kalyan, the way it moves. Now, then I use ga. Then it unfolds in that fashion. Then you can move from ga, then you bridge from ga to pa, because the next nyasa point is pa. So the ma is used as a bridge. Then some people sing in nishada. That's a debatable technical point. But you want to stand on ni, yeah. Then you go to sajja, then you go to gandhara. This is a more known, shall we say, approach. But this is not the approach that essentially defines the raga alapana structure in general. The alapana structure is variant. So it is also possible for me to sing Kalyani in abstract fashion. For example, ta-da-ri-ri, ta-da-ra-na-na-ri, ta-da-ra-ra, ta-da-ra-ra. This is also a very important way of singing Alapana. In this meandering impressionist way, there is a lovely magic that happens, which is very different from the magic that happens when you systematically sing. It's possible to sing a good 25-minute alapana that just... So what is the essence of this alapana? You basically use every phrase to lead to a phrase which is not limited by your compulsion for nyasa. If you are not compelled to do nyasa, and in my honest opinion, nyasa is the easiest way of singing alapana. Because nyasa allows you to then play a lot with a point. But if you remove that as a possibility, then something else happens. And we use both. I think even when we sing nyasa, we use both. We ourselves use the phrase sometimes. We come back to the nyasa sometimes. We do both. So this is important. 2 points before I proceed. The laya of an alapana. What is the laya of an alapana? Every alapana has a laya. And it has inbuilt layers of layas. Two things. There's one overall laya that holds an alapana. And then there's inbuilt layering of laya that happens. There are two things that are important. Is what is the composition I'm going to sing? The laya of the composition, the overall laya of the composition, and the inbuilt layas in the composition should influence the way the alapana is framed. So if I take Kamboji, the same raga, and just quick example, there's a song, I'll just sing the first lines of two songs so you'll understand. majanakiye chatabataga majanakiye chatabataga majanakiye chatabataga majanakiye chatabataga majanakiye chatabataga I was going to sing this. If I sing, it does not fit with my janaki. My alapana maja will be like this. But if I was going to sing, Alapana then can be tadari tarara ranala That is a very important aspect, that the laya of the composition. Similarly, even the length of the alapana is also, in a way, there's a subconscious meter for the musician. It's not a conscious thing. Orangasai is a huge, massive magnus opus canvas painting. Then the alapana can just flow. If I sang Majaniki, and if I sang an alapana that extended for 25 minutes before Majaniki, it's a composition that is, it's a beautiful composition that is a shorter composition. There's an imbalance of aesthetics that happens. So a lot of the length of the alapana is also determined by what is the composition that the musician is going to render. There's another important aspect that happens is the aesthetic connection. Now, just because two things are in Kamboji doesn't mean they're the same, right? Now, if I sang Orangashai, my alapana will be based on the Madhyasthayi Gandhara a lot. For example, if I was going to sing a composition, I'll say a little quick example. There's a composition, Raga Todi. Todi is a South Indian Todi. The start of the composition is on the Devata. It's a very unusual take for Todi. My alapana sometimes will play on that phrase. The whole alapana will be on the da. You don't need to sing on Gandhara everything, because the every composition also has, I think, one motif that is the catch of the composition. There's one approach that encapsulates the whole composition. The musician sometimes can just use tara, 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 ri, 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 ri. just use that da, the whole alapana will be in da. And automatically flow to MEJC. So this is also something that musicians keep in mind. And the emotional content of the alapana is very important. The textural, like in all music, the use of the voice, use of using tada, use of e, a, u, m, the way the voice is given, and that is also there in the breadth of the composition. If the composition is a robust composition, then the alapana usually is also a robust alapana. If the composition is a little meandering and gentler, if I may say so, then the alapana texture also has to have that thing. And I'm only talking about the melodic, rhythmic, laya aspect of the composition, not the textual content of the composition. When I say gentle and robust, it's not about what Tyagaraja is saying. It's about what it sounds like. That's what determines the alapana. Okay?